I guess most of you watch Netflix either because you pay for it or, which is probably more likely, because you are family or friends who pay for it. The amenity of watching your favorite shows or movies without annoying commercials is a huge advantage over television. But do you know how long it took Netflix to become the massive billion-dollar company that it is today? And did you know that one decision by the CEO almost risked the entire venture? As promised, we continue our series about companies that managed to achieve a crazy turnaround story. After our last video about Airbnb, the time has come to talk about the story of Netflix for our third video of the series. Keep watching to find out about the seemingly incredible hurdles that this company had to overcome. Also, don't forget to subscribe to our channel and hit the bell button if you want to see more interesting and educating videos about the world's richest people and companies. Not many know that Netflix was already founded back in 1997 by Mark Randolph and Reed Hastings. Randolph worked as a marketing director for Hastings' company Pure Atria, which developed software and was also the co-founder of Micro Warehouse, a computer mail order company. Hastings, a computer scientist and mathematician, sold Pure Atria to Rational Software Corporation in 1997 for a whopping $700 million, which was, at that point, the biggest acquisition in Silicon Valley history. There are many stories about how the two came up with the idea for Netflix, but one is that the two wanted to combat late fees for video rentals. Hastings invested $2.5 million in startup cash for Netflix, and the company was the world's first online DVD rental store, with around 30 employees and 925 titles available. It had a pay-per-rent model with rates and due dates similar to those of Blockbuster. Basically, you would request a title, get it sent to you via mail, send it back after a few days, and then pay a fee. It took until 1999 for Netflix to introduce the monthly subscription concept and dropping the single rental model. Ever since then, the company has built its reputation on the business model of flat fee unlimited rentals. Netflix had around 300,000 subscribers in 2000, but was still losing money. They offered Blockbuster to acquire them for $50 million. We have also covered this case in our video about the top 10 biggest company fails. If you have seen that video, you will already know that Blockbuster declined the offer, stating that Netflix's business was merely a niche that will never be profitable. What a mistake. In early 2001, Netflix started experiencing fast growth just before the dot-com bubble burst and the September 11 attacks occurred. Both badly affected the company and forced it to lay off one-third of its 120 employees. At this point, Netflix was an inch away from bankruptcy. Still, sales of DVD players finally took off due to prices dropping to roughly $200, which led to DVD players becoming one of the most popular Christmas presents. The ever-increasing number of DVD players in the United States also led to more and more subscribers for Netflix. In May 2002, Netflix went public, selling 5.5 million shares at a price of $15 per share. In 2003, over 6 years after its founding, Netflix finally earned its first profit of around $6.5 million, with a revenue of $272 million. In 2004, Randolph, one of the two co-founders, retired from the company. By 2005, the business was booming. Netflix offered 35,000 different films and sent out 1 million DVDs every single day. It took a while until Netflix could offer movies online due to slow data speeds and high bandwidth costs at that time. In February 2007, the company delivered its billionth DVD and finally began to move away from its original core business of DVDs by introducing video on demand via the internet. But when they finally started offering streaming content for free to its subscribers in 2007, they could offer no more than 1,000 movies and TV shows, just 1% compared to its more than 100,000 different DVD titles. By 2010, Netflix's streaming business had grown so quickly that within months, the company had shifted from the fastest growing customer of the United States Postal Service's First Class service to the largest source of internet streaming traffic in North America during the evening hours. In April 2011, Netflix had over 23 million subscribers in the US and over 26 million worldwide. In July, it began offering a standalone streaming service separate from DVD rentals and charged customers separately. Hastings split up the $10 all-in-one package into two $8 plans, effectively dropping a 60% price increase on his customer base in the middle of a massive recession. The decision resulted in 800,000 people unsubscribing from Netflix in the US and the stock value dropping by 77%. In only 4 months. The company's reputation suffered greatly and critics even nicknamed the CEO Greed Hastings. In September 2011, a new streaming service called Starz announced announced that it would pull its movies from Netflix, sending the company into further crisis. During this time, Netflix was again in huge troubles. However, Netflix was able to bounce back later in the year and improved its revenue by 47% compared to last year. One of Netflix's smartest moves was introducing Netflix original movies and TV shows, its first superb success being House of Cards in 2013. By April 2014, Netflix approached 50 million global subscribers, with a 32% video streaming market share in the US. In 2016, Netflix announced a major international expansion of its service into 150 additional countries. In January 2018, the company crossed $100 billion in market capitalization, becoming the largest digital media and entertainment company in the world. By October of that same year, Netflix's customer base reached 137 million worldwide, confirming its rank as by far the world's biggest online subscription video service. According to Global Internet Phenomena report, Netflix consumes 15% of all internet bandwidth globally, the most by any single application. During the COVID-19 lockdown in 2020, Netflix acquired 16 million new subscribers. If you cannot go outside, what's better than binging another show on Netflix? As you can see, sometimes one small decision, such as changing available plans in the middle of a recession, can almost bankrupt an entire company. Thankfully, Netflix managed to turn the situation around by listening to their customers carefully. Even with The Office and Friends leaving Netflix in 2021, the platform probably won't stop growing anytime soon. Thank you for watching our video. If you like it, please don't forget to subscribe and push the bell button. We will keep uploading educating and interesting videos about the world's richest people and companies. Also, let us know in the comments about your favorite Netflix show. We are currently searching for one after finishing Dark, so every suggestion is well appreciated.